Welcome to another episode of At the Table with Patrick Lencioni, where we explore anything and everything having to do with teamwork, leadership, culture, and other topics related to the world of work. I'm your host, Pat Lencioni. I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, Cody Thompson. How you doing, Cody?
Doing great, Pat.
We have a special guest today, first time ever.
Very special.
Her name is Laura. How do you say her last name?
Lencioni.
Lencioni.
Is that how the telemarketers
Yeah. That's how you know.
Her name is really Laura Lencioni. It's my wife who's filling in for Amy, who couldn't be here today. And it's her birthday. And Laura said, Pat, if you could get me anything for my birthday, you'd let me be on one of your podcasts. Exactly. So here it is.
Thank you so much.
I'm positive that's not what she asked for.
Actually, I had to beg her to be on. Come on, we need help. But she knows about what we're going to talk about today. And it is the concept of vulnerability, something we've been talking about for 22 plus years here at the Table Group.
That's right.
Now, this is Christmas week. And so a lot of people are out there coming home from traveling, or they've just got a little extra time on their hands. So we wanted to make this podcast for those that might want to listen more this week.
Yeah,
so we hope you had a Merry Christmas.
And we actually did this once before Christmas, and we talked about vulnerability, and we listened to it, and we thought we didn't do it justice because it's such an important topic.
That's right.
And so we wanted to get back in the room and re-record it and hope a lot of people benefit from this as they're exploring, you know, stuff they're going to do in their business in the new year and even the time that they're going to spend with their family.
And so the reason why we picked this topic for this Christmas week as the year winds down is, first of all, because this is such an important topic related to everything we do here regarding teamwork and leadership. Secondly, because as we think about improving ourselves, vulnerability really is at the heart of making ourselves better. It's the key to building strong relationships. So we're going to be talking about it professionally today and personally, and you'll be able to apply this to the recent experiences you've had with your family and think about this as you head into the new year as well.
Yeah. And to set this up, Pat, why don't we put it in the context of the five dysfunctions and say, how does vulnerability, because we don't use the word vulnerability in the pyramid, but it's related to trust.
It's all about trust. And trust is the key to building a great team or being a great leader. You know, the first time I started talking about vulnerability is when I wrote my first book, The Five Temptations of a CEO. And what we realized is that if a CEO couldn't be vulnerable, he was not going to engender the trust of his team or her team. And I had an experience really early on. And I think about this, Laura, because it's funny, because we just had our first kids. And you remember those days when the first book came out, we started the company, we bought a house, and you got pregnant with two kids, got pregnant, sounds like.
I do remember that, yes.
Yes. And I had a client, and I was going down to that client a lot while we were raising the boys.
Right.
And right when they were born. And this one guy, famous CEO, could not be vulnerable. He couldn't admit that he had any weaknesses. And we did 360 feedback. We tried to get him to admit it because nobody could trust him. And he would just not admit he had any weaknesses. And it was very interesting early on in our careers to watch this guy lose the entire team and watch a company spiral out of control and go out of business practically, got sold off for a fraction of its worth. And it was all because the CEO just couldn't stand up in front of people and say, I'm not very good at this, or I make mistakes, or I need help.
Right.
Or I'm sorry, I can be a jerk sometimes.
Well, and I think that sometimes it's hard to think that, you know, I think there's a lot of people out there who would say, oh, vulnerability, that's pretty soft, right? Like this is sort of a soft concept. And so we talk about apologizing or saying that you have weaknesses and all that stuff. And there's a tendency to believe, well, that can't make a big difference. It's kind of like a pseudoscience or something, you know, like there's some softness to it. But the reality is if you can't build trust, you can't build a team.
No.
And the most effective way to build trust is by being vulnerable.
And Laura, you were a trainer. You saw this when in your early career, right?
Oh, totally. Yeah.
When a leader couldn't admit they had a problem. And I remember you telling me you used to do some training down in the South. And like you would see, I remember you told me about a guy who was leading a group of all women. Mm-hmm. And they were customer service people.
Oh, right.
And how did it affect him? How does that affect a leader like that? What's the importance of a person's ability to be vulnerable in front of the people they lead?
Well, if they can't show that they're willing to show any
humanity
or fragility or any of that, then nobody trusts them because they're closed off and you can't, then they feel like they can't show anything and they can't be vulnerable and they can't make mistakes and they have to be perfect and closed off. And then it's just
it creates a culture of that.
Yeah, totally.
Yeah, you're totally right. And it has to start at the top. It really does breed, it's like a self-repeating cycle. Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And in fact, as you said, that CEO that I talked about, as a result of him, nobody else on the team ever admitted they had problems.
Right.
And so the company had these huge issues that nobody would ever talk about because nobody wanted to admit they were wrong.
Right, right.
And now, and Alan Mulally is one of our friends. He's the guy who turned around the Ford Motor Company. And one of the most important things he did is he had to teach people how to be vulnerable there. And everybody thinks he had to know a lot about transmissions or technology or manufacturing, but he went in there and had to change his leadership team. And every week they'd stand up and they'd go through their performance, and he'd ask them to rate their performance based on red, yellow, or green. And they would always be green. And the company was hemorrhaging cash and they were almost going out of business, bankrupt. And he was like, how can this be? And then one meeting, one guy finally said, so how's everything going in pickups or whatever? And he was like, red. And everybody was like nervous. And Alan stood up and gave him a standing ovation.
Yeah, started clapping.
That's awesome.
And said, this is what we need to have. And within weeks, there was more red popping up and more red popping up. They started dealing with their real issues and it was liberating.
Well, and the other part of that story is he actually celebrated the person. Everyone thought the first person to say that their department was red was going to get fired.
Right.
And what he did is he, the very next meeting, took the person that said that their department was red, sat him right next to Alan. To say, as like a symbol to say,
right. That's awesome.
I'm rewarding this type of behavior. We have to have this on the team. If we don't, we can't, he has this other phrase, you can't manage a secret, you know? And so basically invulnerability is like keeping secrets.
Yep.
And what he wants and what leaders need is everything to be on the table. Everything you think, every hesitation you have to get into somebody else's sandbox or to say that you are wrong or... And this happened even at our company in the last couple of weeks. And in terms of, we thought we had an accountability problem, right? We thought, oh, we really just need to hold each other more accountable. And underneath all of that, we went down the pyramid to actually we had a vulnerability problem. We had a trust problem.
People were guarding themselves. Even in a team that tries to practice this for 20 years, people were guarding themselves. And if you don't address that, you can't address all the other issues.
Right. And sometimes it can be super well-intentioned. It can be like, well, I'm not going to say this because I don't want to hurt that person's feelings, or I'm not going to say this because who knows what they're going to think. And really the vulnerable act in that sense is to just to say, go to them and say, hey, I'm a little nervous because I feel like I have something to offer to you or your department or how you're showing up at work. And I'm nervous you're going to hate me for it. That's vulnerability in and of itself.
Right. Yeah. Buck naked, as we say. It's one. And here's the deal. If you think you want your teammates to do this, because we're going to talk about teamwork in a second, the leader has to go first. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Teams just almost never become vulnerable if the leader won't do it.
Right.
Now, so what we do with the leader is we're like, you have to admit, you have to start by diving into the pool first and admitting what you're not good at, the issues you have. And if you're not going to meetings and acknowledging when you're wrong, if you're not apologizing when it's warranted, nobody's going to do that for each other.
Right.
But let's talk now about teamwork.
Right.
Because most people listening to this, if they know any of our stuff, are probably thinking about vulnerability-based trust, which is at the bottom of the pyramid. So when we go in with a team, the first thing we do, we don't care if they take our team, our online assessment, and they get green on trust and red on all the other four, we still say, let's build even more trust. Mm-hmm. And that what we do to build trust is nothing short of just getting them to be vulnerable with each other. Mm-hmm. And so what we do is we do something called the personal histories exercise, which sounds soft, and it's really simple. You know, Laura, I come home from offsites and I tell you the stuff we learn, but it's really just about people getting vulnerable.
Yeah. And it is simple. It's three questions, right? Yep. And two of them are, you know, where did you grow up and what order are you in your family?
Right.
So those are softball type questions.
Yep.
And then the third is, what is the thing you struggled most with as a child? What was the most difficult thing you encountered as a child?
Right.
And you would be surprised, and we're surprised every single time we're in a room, that people end up sharing things that, even if they're on a team where they've worked with everyone on that team for 10 years, they'll share something and we'll ask at the end, who, you know, raise your hand if you learned something new about someone else around the table. And without a doubt, without fail, everyone,
every hand goes up and people will say, I had no idea that happened when you were a kid.
Right.
And take any eight group of people and ask them about their childhood, and someone has a parent who died or a family that moved all the time, or they had a learning disability or a really difficult situation with one of the members of the family. And we don't go deep into that. We're not trying to get into their inner childhood and get naked and everything.
Right.
But we just have them say that out loud. And suddenly everybody admires each other more.
Absolutely. To make it super practical, one of our favorite examples that we use is an executive team that was sharing this. They get to the CFO, who's sort of perceived as like kind of curmudgeon-y and tight-fisted and doesn't approve a lot of budgetary, you know, discretionary budgets right. and stuff like that. And it gets to him and they ask, you know, he gets to the third question and he says, well, growing up, the most difficult thing for us was we were really poor. And oftentimes the electricity was shut off or our water was shut off. And I just hate the idea of ever getting to a place where we don't have what we need financially. And one of the other guys on the team is like, oh, that's why you don't, you know, that's why you're kind of tight with the budget. Not because you hate us or you don't want us to, you know, have discretionary budget for our areas of concern. And he says, no, I never want the company to ever be in a position where we don't have the money that we need. And so this is where it
suddenly everything changes.
Right. It totally changes there. And this is why it's so practical about building a team, right? Because as soon as you have, you're willing to be vulnerable in that way, it releases everyone else to not only understand you, give you permission, you know, about some of the behavior that you're bringing to the table. That's just part of who you are. And then it establishes this basis of trust that everything else comes from.
Right. And it's liberating.
Right. And at the same time, when people are sharing these stories and they're really heartfelt and they're deep, and then somebody comes along and stops it and just doesn't share anything and takes that whole thing and just screeches it to a halt and says, oh, I didn't really have anything tough growing up.
Right. And you can feel the whole room.
Yeah. And you know, they are not vulnerable, and you can just see that's going to be kind of going on.
You know what I do when that happens, Laura, is what? I will stop and go, really? There's nothing? And they're like, no. And so sometimes you can tell though, that they're like, they actually feel bad.
Right.
Cause they're like, I think that's totally different. And I'm like, well, that was probably your challenge then, because as you hear these, and they're like, totally. Right. I'm like, when's the other shoe going to drop?
Right.
But sometimes it's just a matter of not opening up. But you know something? That's why we try to go with the leader first.
Right.
The leader has to open up
and sets the tone. Mm-hmm. But you're right. There is the sincere side where someone truly doesn't have a problem when they're growing up. But then there's the side where sometimes when it comes to a screeching halt like that, that's the member of the team that can't be vulnerable. And you say all the time, if even one member of the team cannot open up and be vulnerable, it drastically changes the dynamic of the whole team.
Absolutely. If that person's the leader, it's the worst, but even one other person on the team. Now, so then after we do that, we go and do something like the Myers-Briggs. Mm-hmm. And there's a bunch of other tools out there and everybody's like, which tool do you use? And I love the Myers-Briggs, but there's other tools too. But the key is just this. Is it getting at people's underlying vulnerabilities? So the purpose, and Laura, you're the one that brought the Myers-Briggs to the table group. Mm-hmm. So how does the Myers-Briggs allow people to admit their weaknesses in a way that's relatively safe?
Oh, because it's actually written there for you. I mean, when you figure out your type, you go, oh, these are my strengths and these are my weaknesses. And it's okay because everybody else has their page that says strengths and weaknesses. So you're like, okay, everybody's got these. So that's okay.
Exactly. Now, Laura, I once did the most powerful example of this, of how vulnerability can help a team, is a guy that had your personality type. Barry was his name. Barry Engelman. Shout out to Barry. Barry's a great guy. And Barry was on a team with a guy and they weren't getting along. And Barry read out his Myers-Briggs type. And I remember it well. He said, I'm an INFP. It says here I'm a perfectionist. And so I like to procrastinate if I can't do it the right way. And so sometimes I wait till the last minute. Mm-hmm. And the guy sitting across the table who he didn't get along with said, read that again. And Barry said, and he read it again. He goes, so you don't do that to piss me off? And Barry is like, no, this is just how I am.
Right.
And the guy said, do you want me to help you with that? And he goes, oh, I would love you to help me with that. Right. And suddenly they started working together because the other guy thought he did it on purpose.
Yeah.
Right. And this gets at something we call the fundamental attribution error. Laura, you were a psych major in school. Do you remember the fundamental attribution error?
Yeah, but I can't say it right now.
Put you on the spot. Yeah. That's just where we tend to attribute other people's behaviors that we don't like to their character. We think they're doing it on purpose. Yeah. So a guy cuts you off in traffic and you go, what a jerk.
Right.
Then you cut somebody else off in traffic and you're like, I'm late. I'm sorry. Yeah, right. I don't know where I'm going. And so when you do the Myers-Briggs, suddenly you go and you learn their personal history. You can trust them because they've been vulnerable to you. You know about them. It changes everything on a team. And if that's soft,
I know.
Then I'll take soft every
absolutely.
Day.
Right.
Yeah, but it's anything but soft. No. And it really is. It drastically changes the dynamic of the team. And even on our team, I'll reiterate, like after years and years of practicing this, after having an organization that we'd often go out and say, yeah, we you know, drink our own champagne or eat our own dog food or whatever it is.
Oh, yeah.
We still had room to increase the depth of our vulnerability and trust.
Well, mm-hmm. It's not like, unlike marriage.
Right.
You know, we've been married for 27 years, half of my life. And in the last 3 years, we've had breakthroughs that are just crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And you would think, well, what's wrong with your marriage if you're still having breakthroughs in? It's like nothing. It never ends.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I actually sometimes can, when I explain what you do to other people, I say it's kind of marriage counseling for executive teams.
Right.
Because it's helping them really trust each other and be open with each other and honest and everything you need in a marriage.
Totally.
Well, and you know what we find? And that's why working here has helped us all in our family life. But we find so many leaders that say, I'm bringing this to my home too. Mm-hmm. And so it's interesting that you mentioned that, because, and especially during this week when we're around our friends and family a lot, this is so critical in our personal lives as well. And I've used the same stuff I do. I've had friends who were like, we're not getting along. We're thinking about separating. And I'm like, what's your Myers-Briggs types? And we figured it out. And I'm like, can you admit this? And they're like, oh yeah, I'm just like that. I'm like, can you admit this? Yeah, I'm just like that. God wired you this way. Yeah. You're not doing this to tweak each other. And they're like, you're kidding. So when you want him to do it differently, it's actually against his grain. Mm-hmm. He can try, but he's not doing this because he wants to make you mad. He's doing it because that's kind of how he is.
Well, and it's not about providing an excuse, but it's just about understanding how we're wired and how we show up. And everyone has to work outside of their own comfort zone in work or at home at certain points.
Hopefully not all the time.
Yeah. And what it does is it just gives you that framework for understanding who someone is, what their weaknesses are, for them to actually extrovert those and say, hey, here's how I show up and here's how I know that bothers you. And it is absolutely, I actually find myself taking the personal histories exercise and using it. I've used it at home. I've used it with my wife. And it really does speak to the way that you build deep relationship. Because I took that exercise. I've been meeting with a group from my church, a men's group that we meet once a month. And after 5 months, I was like, man, you know, you don't build relationships with time. A lot of people think that it's with time.
Right.
Because, oh, all my best friends I've known since I was young.
They think that at work too. Like we've worked together for 8 years.
Right.
Sometimes they've never gone deep.
Yeah, exactly. And the thing is, time helps because it actually helps you facilitate more vulnerable conversations because you've had more time and exposure to one another. But so after five of these little meetings, I was like, man, I really just want us to go deeper faster. So I took the personal histories exercise, and seven or eight guys did it around a table, and everyone left like, wow, we just fast-tracked getting to know each other by a year. You know,
and it's all about vulnerability.
And it's all about vulnerability.
Which, again, is not something, it's not unnatural. Nobody should get up in front of people and pretend to cry or be more, just be real. Mm-hmm. Just go, this is what happened when I was a kid. This is kind of how it screwed me up, or this is kind of how it challenged me. And it's okay that you guys know that.
Totally.
And suddenly it goes deeper. Tell us about, you were talking about, you were assessing your friends, how deep your friendships were.
Yeah. So this is what I do when I drive. I just start thinking, you know, I have a 3-hour drive to Tahoe or something. And I'm like, let me see how I can apply this to other things in my life. But essentially I was thinking about all the relationships I have in my life. And I thought, I was going through all my friends and trying to figure out like, who do I think I have the most depth of a relationship with and why? And I started to realize that it was almost exclusively around vulnerability. I've had more vulnerable conversations with the friends I'm closer to than the ones I haven't. Mm-hmm. And one of my friends stood out in my mind where I thought, man, I've known this guy for a long time. I know this part of his past that we've never talked about. It's out there. His dad passed early in his life and we've never talked about it. And I thought the longer I went without talking about it, the more it felt like I couldn't go there.
Oh,
right.
Exactly.
So we'd known each other for a decade. And the next time we got together, I said, hey, you know, I feel so bad that I've never asked you about this, that I've never asked you about your dad or how, you know, how it's affected you. And we had a great conversation. And I kid you not, the moment from that moment to the next time we hung out, it was like I had a different friend, you know, a deeper friendship.
Yep.
And so again, I can't say enough. If you think this is soft, if you think this won't matter, as you're around your family this week, you know, after Christmas, or if you're still with them leading into the new year, try this.
Right.
You know, go be a little vulnerable with people. Tell them what you're worried about in the coming year, or say what you think you're not great at and that someone could help you with.
And I think Amy told us this recently, or if you had a difficult moment with somebody, do something that freaks them out and call them and say, I'm really sorry. I think I probably didn't make you comfortable right there. And I want to apologize. it changes the nature of a relationship.
Completely.
I remember when I was, I think I might've been like 14 when I learned this. My little sister, she's 5 years younger than me. She was probably 9. And I remember I made her mad, as brothers do. And I remember she leaves the room and I was sitting there thinking, I felt kind of bad that she felt bad, but you know, I was like, whatever. And then I thought, you know, I should go apologize to her. And it kind of sucked at first. And then she was so glad and I felt so relieved. And from that day on, I remember thinking, this is ridiculous that we don't do this.
Right.
Right.
As crazy as that is.
Well, and if there's anyone out there that's still, you know, wondering if this really works, here's what you do. The next time you have an argument, like you said, with someone you love, could be your spouse, a friend, whoever, normally our tendency is to be invulnerable, to go back and construct.
Yep. Very natural.
Oh, you know what? Here's why I'm right. And then you're going to go back into the second round of the argument and say, I figured it out. Here's why you're not understanding me. Rather than do that, think about, how did I contribute to this? What was my part in this? How did I make this spiral out of control? And then go and the title of this podcast is Start With Vulnerability, right?
Yep.
Go back and say, I'm so sorry.
Yes, start with that.
I'm sorry that I screwed up this way. And it will change the whole conversation.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Now, don't say that if you didn't. That's disingenuous.
Right.
But we always do. There's plenty for us to do that. But begin with the part that you did wrong.
Exactly.
Right.
You know, there's a reason why AA does this. There's a reason why we go to confession. There's a reason why this is part of our life. Because being vulnerable, I mean, there's a reason why, you know, on this Christmas week, Jesus came into the world and was vulnerable and poor. There's real power in the love of being vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And yes, it's true for CEOs. Yes, it's true for team members, and it's true in our families. Now, I have to say that I feel sorry for our kids, Laura, because they bring home their girlfriends. Oh. We have 4 boys. And they make a bet. They're like, okay, how long do you think before dad starts talking about the Myers-Briggs?
Right, right. Yeah.
And I'm extroverted. Laura's thinking it too.
But I'm typing them right away.
Yeah. And the funny that they always like it, but we get to know them. And we're like, and then
fast.
We get
fast. Like, super fast.
And then we can go, oh, that's why they do that. And we even talk to them about, hey, this is why you guys get along, or this is going to be a little stressful for you. Like, one of our sons is an ENFP, like me and you, Cody, mm-hmm. and his girlfriend, who's wonderful, is an ISFJ.
ISFJ, yeah.
So this is you and your wife.
Yep.
We told them about you guys, Cody, and he'll say, now he's in college. She'll say, what time are we going to go see your family? And he's like, probably about noon. And they arrive at our house at 3. And she says, yeah, I had to wait for him for an hour and a half. And we're like, okay, Matt, this is not an excuse.
Right.
But here's what you need to understand, Madison. He's an ENFP. And she's like, I know, because he cares so much. But he starts talking to a friend and then something else happens. And you can explain those things. It just makes life a lot easier.
Right, right.
My wife, after 7 years of marriage, she's like, yeah, don't do the ENFP thing. You know.
Like, yes.
I know, but in the grand scheme of things, just know that this is who I am.
Well, and that's great because we have that vocabulary where we can go, I know you're an ENFP, but we have to be on time. Yep. As opposed to saying, don't be disrespectful and don't be a jerk.
Right.
Right.
It's like, no, actually God wired me this way. I have to override it this time, but at least you have a frame of reference for this is who I am.
Yeah. And it's not a blind spot. My wife and I are very aware of my weaknesses, especially as it aligns with punctuality, for sure.
Laura, did we tell you about how he went to the airport in Utah earlier this year?
No.
And he left the keys at home?
No.
And they got to the airport and they go, my backpack's missing. Oh, that's okay. No, my keys are in it. And she looked at him. He's like, hey, you know what you got with me? Okay. Yeah.
Well, no, what happened was I said, okay, I put her and the baby on the plane and I said, okay, I'm going to try to make this work. I called my mom, had her meet me halfway. I was like, but either way, you guys are getting on this plane and getting out of here. I arrive minutes in time to get on the plane. And I'm like, wouldn't it be way less fun to be married to somebody else? You know? I'm not sure she believes that.
Exactly.
But
this is so important. Now, and as parents, I don't know if people are listening out there, parents, you're a new parent, Cody, but Laura and I were talking about this on the way over. When a parent can be vulnerable with their kids, it's a powerful thing. When a parent can say things like, yeah, I think you're right. Actually, I think I was wrong. Or I'm sorry, I don't think I was fair. It's a powerful thing.
Yeah.
That doesn't mean you do it just to fake it, or you do it all the time because you want to be their friend, because that's a terrible way to become the wrong kind of friend. But it's a very powerful thing because it teaches your kids to grow up that way.
Right, right.
And I think Laura and I grew up in an era where parents generally didn't say they were sorry a lot.
Yeah, ours never did.
Or admit they were wrong.
No.
And I kind of thought that's what it meant to be a parent.
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, and that also transferred to the boss mentality. I mean, you said that there's a whole generation of people out there who believed in the adage, don't let them see you sweat,
right.
You know? And so if there are leaders out there, or parents out there, people out there who still ascribe to that, we're missing out on a way of building deep relationship and trust.
And as I like to say, if you're sweating and you're a leader or a parent, lift up your arm, point to your armpit and say, check this out.
Yep.
and let people know you're aware of your humanity. And the funny thing is, when you're a leader or a team member or a parent and you're vulnerable, people want to walk through walls of fire for you. Because they're like, I can trust you. You're human.
Right.
But when you pretend you're perfect, when you pretend you don't have to admit you're wrong, people do not trust you because they think I can only trust them as far as I can coddle their fragile ego.
Right.
Right.
And that's not a good thing to do.
No.
All right. This is our Christmas week podcast. We hope you're having safe travels out there. Getting back, Laura, happy birthday.
Thank you.
Happy birthday.
It's so great to have you here. Yeah. How fun. Cody, I hope you have a good few more days off. We just kind of came down to the office today to do this, but we'll have one more podcast before the end of the year. And until then, we want to wish everybody happy holidays and say God bless.